Best way of cooking, I think it's difficult to kind of define what is the best way of cooking because it may not give you the desired results every time. So, you know, one way to simply put it is steaming food is the best way, but is it desirable? Is it sustainable? No. So, because, you know, plus you cannot steam every food and eat it. It's impossible. Nobody is going to follow that diet. So I think the best way of cooking any dish in a layman's term, if I have to put, is to be conscious of what you are putting, what you are adding. And more or less, we have a certain level of knowledge. Everybody knows what is good and what is bad. You don't need to be a doctor to understand that if you eat fried food all the time, or if you're eating charred food or grilled food all the time, that is going to be healthy for you. So there is a certain basic knowledge and understanding we all possess. When we put that butter on the bread, or when we add that extra dollop of cream on your favorite palak paneer, or when we order that extra cheese pizza, we already know that we are eating, let's say in this particular three cases, excess fat. Similarly, there could be excess carbs, there could be excessive eating. So method of cooking is not the culprit, I always say. And also, you know, we have this tendency as individuals, not as doctors, but as individuals, to define food as healthy and unhealthy. I personally feel that there is no such food which is unhealthy at all. It is our intake, it is our lifestyle that makes it unhealthy for us. So where if I am used to working out, if I'm a very active person, I can take enough of, let's say, for example, ghee. I'm keeping other parameters as okay, where I don't have a certain condition or I'm not allergic to certain things. So it is not unhealthy for me because I'm able to burn it out. But at the same time, if I'm sedentary and if I'm somebody who is unable to move around, whether it's for old age or some incapacity, I need to reduce my certain foods. That's all. So no food is unhealthy. Every food gives you nutrition. The art of balancing nutrition from every meal, every ingredient is what we need to focus. And that's where we learn, not necessarily from chefs, but from nutritionists, from doctors who kind of recommend certain things to eat and in proportion. And like I said, everybody has a basic knowledge of what is right and what is wrong. And when you get interested about such things, the information is right there, right? Somebody who's listening to or watching us now, there's a whole lot of information that from Dr. Sisodia to Mr. Chadda to Tiana, everybody has already shared. So it's all about implementing, keeping that and moving on. Now, talking about certain foods that that one can have while they are on, let's say, a certain recovery, whether it's from COVID or not. And also personally, let's say if somebody is trying to rebuild, whether he was suffering from COVID or not, or kind of getting onto a recovery road, I think there are certain parameters from what I understand as a chef I can share. One is definitely proteins, because those are your building blocks in your body. So whether it's a plant-based protein or if it's a animal-based protein, that is important. Then it comes to fats. Fats are very important, but the good fats. Let's say if you're taking fats in terms of eating almonds or eating different kinds of nuts. So this is a good source of fat. Similarly, there are certain healthy oils as well. So you cannot have a fat-free diet. It's not good for our own body. Similarly, limiting your carbs or taking carbs in the form of carbs coming from, let's say, a whole wheat or a whole meal or a mixed grain meal rather than a very super refined flour, for example. So there are these subtle things. At the same time, somebody who's recovering, I think fresh food, freshly prepared, helps a lot. When I say fresh food, it should be seasonally available fresh fruits and vegetables, something that you can eat raw, something which requires minimalistic cooking. For example, if you want to eat chaat, right? So you can always add a whole lot of sprouts to your chaat to make it more healthy. Like someone was talking that the moment you sprout a dal, you are increasing the iron absorption or the iron or the nutrients. Jab wo sprout banta hai, it kind of increases. In fact, some time back, 2-3 years back, I had this entire craze about doing micro, these small little micros that you can grow from seeds, different seeds at home. All you need is a little small bowl and with a cotton pad, add some water, add some, let's say, throw in mustard seeds and you get those small little shoots and you cut them and you eat them and they don't taste much. They're not a mouthful, but they're very nutritious. So these are the few things that I can put forward. And I mean, the list is endless. There are so many other things that you can kind of eat while you're on the road to recovery. And one of the important things is that to not overindulge, because the moment you are into that recovery mode, you start feeling hungry, you tend to go back to the same old habits. Hey, yaar, ab to main patla ho gaya, ab to theek hai, I need nutrition, Baba. Wo that theory and that thought in the head, you really have to fight it and kind of pace out your meals. I've been somebody on to a very high side of weight and kind of reduced it over a period of time. I've realized one of the things that works for me is portioning, at the same time having a right time to eat. So I try and limit my dinners. There are a handful of days that I actually indulge in a nice good meal and then, you know, go off to bed. Otherwise, I usually try and finish a light meal by 7:30. So that has really helped me. Somebody who asked me, how did you do it? What are you eating? What is your diet plan? I said, you know what? I've just had like liquid dinner, literally maybe a glass of milk or a fruit or maybe a small bun. But the rest of the day I've been eating. So that really helps. And again, it's very, dependent upon body to body, type to type. And that's where doctors and nutritionists come into play, who give you a certain, who identify you as a body type and then kind of suggest you or recommend you a certain diet to follow. And that's where the chefs come in to make sure that it's nutritious. At the same time, it's tasty. I think local berries are fabulous. They're full of antioxidants. They're small. They don't fill you up as much, but yet they give you a whole lot of nutritional benefit. So, you know, every state, and I've been doing a bit of research. I'm trying to put a book together on different local ingredients. So I've been researching that every state has a certain berry that comes in a certain season. For example, I'm in Delhi right now. Delhi UP belt has this falsa that comes in. And I was just reading about it, that it is high on, now it's all Google information, so I can't vouch for it, but that's what it says. And somebody who over here, if you can kind of enlighten, it'll be great. But it is full of vitamin C, it is full of antioxidants, it's a small berry. It is, you can just keep snacking on it. So rather than replacing your, trying to go on a crash diet, replace your butter popcorns while you're watching your Amazon or Netflix with a healthier berry. Similarly, if you go towards the northern Indian belt, abhi mil rahe Kilmora. Kilmora is a tiny little yellow-colored raspberry, which is very, very indigenous to this entire belt. And it's a brilliant, very tasty, very elusive. If you're in somebody who's staying in the hills, you really don't have to make an effort, because bazaar mein nahi milti, aapke ghar ke bahar ya kahin road pe wo ped laga hoga, tod tod ke sab kha rahe hote. So I think a simple thing like going out and researching which fruit belongs to which season and pick that up as a snack is one of the wonderful things. Other thing, I think another thing which is really coming up is chia seeds. Now, chia seeds is simple seeds, which are basically, they belong to the same as the mint family, though they have don't taste like mint. They actually taste like nothing because it doesn't have any taste. It's more playful. It looks like that chote dana falude ka, more like what sabza is, which is basil seeds, tulsi ke beech. Very similar looking. They kind of puff up. They give a lot of nutrition. They give a lot of fiber and they naturally curb your hunger. So somebody who was planning to kind of start reducing, because hamara sirf COVID-19 mein, undernutrition is not the only problem. Ke koi COVID se suffer hua, jo COVID se bilkul suffer nahi hua, wo bhi, he has gained a lot of weight. And gaining weight is the biggest disease, I feel. Kyunki that complicates everything in your system. So we need to address undernutrition, whereas we also need to address overnutrition, because ye dono cheeze chal rahi hai side by side. Ghar pe jo baitha hai, jo COVID se bach gaya, thankfully, वो मोटापे से पॉसिबली डील कर रहा, बिकॉज एवरीबडी इज जस्ट सिटिंग एंड ईटिंग. सो आई थिंक चिया सीड्स और सब्जा और तुलसी के बीज होते हैं, पानी में भिगोने होते हैं 20 मिनट 25 मिनट, दे ब्लूम, दे सोक अप अ लॉट ऑफ वाटर, And once you consume it, it naturally curbs your hunger. Up, you start eating less. Plus, they give you nutrition. Aisa nahi hai ki wo empty calories hai.